had a first year and then
When you're talking with people who don't understand this, and you're talking with people who live particularly in the Chicagoland area where cost of living is higher, I know that some of the concerns I've run into are, well, you have to pay doctors more if you want to retain good doctors in these areas where they see a higher volume of patients and their costs of living are higher in order for them to live in a safe neighborhood close to the location of the hospital. If it's a fixed rate going into these hospitals, and to be clear, I'm all in favor of eating the rich. I think that's a fabulous idea. We should do that now. However, when you're selling this to people, how do you answer the question of, well, if you're paying everybody the same, then how do you deal with these disparities in cost of living and attracting and retaining top talent in hospitals in areas where the cost of living is higher?
Well, the reimbursement rates will be a product of negotiation between doctors' representatives, hospital representatives, and whoever the government representatives are. And they will have to work that out. So they will have to, if there's a great disparity in cost of living in, you know, rural area versus the big city, then the doctors and the hospital administrators and the government administrators are the best people to work that out. So it would be very hard for us to, you know, just to lay down the law.
So, good point.
I'm sorry, I
would like to add on something real quick to that. Because it's an interesting point about the cost, because, you know, my wife's internal medicine doctor, she was offered double her salary to go to Southern Illinois because they don't have, they're desperate for doctors down there. Meanwhile, up in a more affluent area, she spends 25% of her workday on the phone with insurance companies. And she likes to point out, she didn't go to med school to be an unpaid bureaucrat for the insurance company. She does not get paid for that time she spends a quarter of her day on the phone with them, but she's doing it to save her patients' lives because she has to pull and tug with them to cover her patients. They are incentivized to deny coverage. Every dollar they spend taking care of their patients is one less dollar in their pockets.
I love that. That's the framing I was looking for. Thank you.
Okay. I'm sorry, just tell me.
So actually, just kind of two questions. So the plan that you spoke of, and I was unaware of this, if this is the case, does it get rid of the fee-for-service payment model?
Because
you talked about global budgets in one of the slides, which, you know, would seem to get away from the fee-for-service.
Well, as I understand it, those doctors who work for, you know, our employees, essentially at hospitals or clinics, that will be negotiated, and then there will be a fee structure for services for those doctors or clinics that are not part of an employer. So no, the fee-for-service model will still be there, and I'm not 100% sure of this, but I believe the fee for those doctors, let's say, who are still in private practice, and the numbers are declining all the time as more and more get hired by hospitals.
Right.
But as I understand it, there will still be a fee for service for those doctors, and those fees will be negotiated, you know, for a year or 2 years. I don't know how long the period will be. So there will still be a fee for service. Yeah.
Well, and the reason I ask is because, like, my biggest issue with the concept of Medicare for All is not that I have an issue with single payer, I just have an issue with any privatization of the healthcare system. Like, why don't you go that step further and just nationalize it all? Make the doctors government employees.
Employees?
Nationalize the hospitals. Like, why don't you go that step further to really...
That's the way Britain does theirs. Yeah.
No, absolutely. Like, why not take it that step further?
Well, I don't know. I guess there's no good, you know, maybe it's just considered a step too far for the United States.
I think that's what it is.
I deal a lot with the moderate middle in my day-to-day work for a nonprofit, and the moderate middle would not buy into that. Mm-hmm. They would be terrified. They're terrified of this too. So they're like, more terrified of that. I have a sense for where they're at. I really do, especially the over 60 crowd. And
but then I guess you feel like you're just negotiating against yourself at that point.
I agree with you. I agree with you, but you're dealing with emotions, not rationality. At a certain point, like I get where you're coming from, and I think it's a good idea. It's just that the transition to try and get people to buy into that, you can see like the nodding heads here.
Yeah.
When you're working particularly with rural Americans who are living on $700 a month and have already lost their coverage, they've got no doctors they can go to, they're watching their family members die, they are not okay with anything that has to do with the government to begin with. And then to say, oh, well, your doctors aren't even going to, they can't even have their private practices anymore, they're going to have to work for the government, they don't trust the government well enough to go for that. And I suspect you would also have an inverse way on that for people who are on the far left, too, even though that doesn't make any sense to me, but that's what I see, speaking from my...
No, I just want everyone to have access.
I agree.
And... like what we do with the drugs, like one of the slides where you got the drugs on there, the one drug Advair is a drug that it's for asthma.
Mm-hmm.
It's literally two generic drugs combined. The patent is on the inhaler, not the actual medication, and that's ridiculous. That it costs, if you don't have insurance, $1,200 a month to have this. When if you take it every day, you probably won't have an asthma attack. Where you have to go to the hospital. And, I mean, people in this country die of asthma attacks, even though we know how to prevent them. We know how to treat them if we have it. There's no reason for, so you know, and that's one of the preventable things that we have, and it's just so unnecessary.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions?
I think you asked for admission of $3,000 for that convention in Chicago.
Yeah.
Southern Alabama, same thing. And you were concerned about keeping talent affordable in Chicago or whatever. By the same token, do the people in Chicago who are getting their $3,000 say, I'm out of this mess, I'm moving to Southern Mississippi, Southern Alabama, where I get the same amount of money, I can work the same hours, and I live so much cheaper.
You're talking about the doctors?
Mm-hmm. Where you have the negotiated price that's nationwide the same.
I think he was talking about there also being a negotiated hourly rate for
the
employers being the fix for that.
They're already incentivized to do that,
by
the way. Like I just said, you know, my wife could double her salary going to Southern Illinois.
Yeah, I can understand
that. Way from the Chicago area.
Do they get a lot of takers?
Well, you know, that's the other thing.
Yeah, I mean, someone says,
who wants to go live in Southern Illinois?
Chicago, well, I want to live in Illinois.
But they're incentivized, and, you know, also, hospital. We just closed another hospital in Chicago the other day. What was that one, Bill?
Mid-South, it was called.
Yeah, Mid-South. Yeah, we're facing the same problems in Chicago that you're facing in rural areas where, you know, like Bill said earlier about the way healthcare is incentivized for the wealthy. Well, that's not big chunks of the city. And as you see, if you remember that other slide, you could go two L stops down, and you're talking about life expectancy dropping 20 years.
Yeah.
And sure, people will talk about the other, you know, external factors, but the healthcare is a big part of it. Especially when you think about all the complications that just come from the way poverty kills, you know, aside from...
Those people are right next to a World Class Medical Campus.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's a good question. I don't know how to answer the question about the differential in pay when you consider rural versus
And maybe what I'm thinking of is very unique in the sense that, there'd be some that would do that, but there's more people there.
I think
I'd like to ask a question.
I'm an accountant, so I always look at these little things about what happens.
Well, any other questions?
Yeah.
Will?
No questions.
Okay.
Yeah, I got plenty of questions. I'll ask questions all night if you'll say it.
Does it include mental health care? I didn't see any mention of that, and I feel like that needs to be a huge part of the discussion. Mental health care, it was in there, okay.
It did cover basically anything that you could think of that didn't help.
Sometimes people ask, what's gonna happen to all the superfluous administrative people in the insurance companies and the hospitals? And it could be as many as a half a million people who are not needed. There was a comparison between the administrative staff in a big hospital in Rochester versus administrative staff in my hospital in Montreal, and it was like hundreds and hundreds of people. And the answer to that is that there's money in the bill to help them make the transition. There's money in the bill to give them severance pay for a year or so, to continue paying their retirement if their retirement comes from, and also to, I think they get 2 or 4 years of college paid for so they can make a transition.
That's pretty special.
It's a pretty generous package for any people who might lose their job as a result of Medicare for All.
And I would assume in doing that calculation and everything, they've already calculated in the fact that this is all being paid through what the Medicare, Medicaid.
Yeah, that's likely.
Is that basically the existing system right now?
Yes.
So a lot of those people, I would logically think they have to transfer that to gear up for a much larger operation.
Yes, that's possible.
That was what I was going to mention. I think this is a phony argument, frankly, because you know when we have actual Medicare, improved Medicare for All, single payer legislation that comes into force, there's going to be so many people flooding the system that you're going to need all those extra people to handle all the paperwork. And I mean, that over time, that'll probably, you know,
level off,
but it's still going to employ almost everybody except mid and upper management.
But they have to be trained, of course, to be.
But they'll be doing more or less what they were doing before, except denying care. That's the only thing they'll be doing differently.
That's not a good preparation for any other kind of.
Yeah.
So it looks like if Bernie Sanders wins or something like that, and the other, Jayapal's bill would be more likely to go through since there's way more
sponsors.
Yeah, way more sponsors than there are.
Yeah, I think the deciding factor is going to be the arguments and the opposition from the insurance companies and their allies in the legislature, which would be pretty ferocious. Because we're really talking about eliminating their role in healthcare, because they don't have a role, actually.
Well, both of them would be eliminated. Both of them would do that, wouldn't they?
Yes,
both of them.
And there are a number of other bills that are being put forward that are kind of like half measures and quarter measures, some by Democrats, some by Republicans, about buying into Medicare, different kinds of public option. The problem with all of those is they do nothing to limit the power of the insurance companies.
Right.
Just like the Affordable Care Act, while it accomplished some things, the insurance companies are arguably stronger now than they were then. Their stock prices went through the roof after the Affordable Care Act was passed. So
they had, 6 months, a year, 2 years to get their prices where they wanted them to be before things started kicking in?
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah.
Something like that. I mean, where it was no surprise.
And unless we can, we'll never get cost control as long as the insurance companies are running the system.
Yeah.
In places like Switzerland and Germany, where they have private insurance companies, they are highly controlled by the government. And I haven't verified this, but in Switzerland, if an insurance company makes a profit, it has to share it with all the other insurance companies. You can imagine how well that would go over the United States.
Right.
Those are fighting words. I can't imagine. So the question is then, what are the chances of this ever happening? You know, I mean, given the power of big business versus the power of ordinary people. And it seems to me the answer is it's only going to happen through a really powerful grassroots movement.
Yes.
That is going to involve millions and millions of people in turmoil who won't be fooled by these decoy programs. And if you had said 3 years ago, what's the chances of single payer happening? I would have said not very good. But now it's beginning to look like a possibility. And I'm sure of that because you can tell by the reaction of the insurance companies. They've put together a big fund. that they're starting their ad campaigns. They have people like Rahm Emanuel on TV telling lies about single payer.
And Rahm Emanuel too.
What?
People like Rahm Emanuel and Rahm Emanuel.
I don't know how popular he is.
So I'm going to go ahead and, speaking of fighting words here, I'm going to go ahead and bring it up here. What's the framing on how you answer the question about abortion?
Well, that's a good question. I'd say, and I would, from me, I mean, for a white male, I would say something like, reproductive rights are part of healthcare.
Right.
And we should have them, and you know, we can. If you oppose abortion, you can educate people and explain your position. And but the government shouldn't be denying women reproductive rights.
Of course.
I guess that
Supreme Court.
That's as
laws change. You never know what we'll be talking about a year or two from now, but.
I would say that so far that has not come up, which just surprised me. What is going to come up is immigrants. Should they be getting health care?
It is already an issue. It is already there. I will tell you, and I will speak as somebody who, you know, some of the folks in here will attest to the amount of time that I spend teaching the center what the left is about. I spend a lot of time at it. I will tell you the two arguments that you are dealing with in the Democratic base that you need to know about. There is a substantial proportion of the Democratic base that absolutely does not believe that abortion on demand should be allowed. And single payer for all, they are opposed to it, although they will not say it outright, they are opposed to it because their tax dollars would be used to fund abortions. That is something that we need strong framing for. We need a scaffold, we need to talk about reproductive rights, and we need to talk about it in terms of reproductive justice, which is all about making sure that you are providing an answer to the disparity in maternal death rates and maternal mortality rates. That needs to be a part of the discussion too. If you're not already listening to people about that, you have a group in Chicago that you should be listening to called Sister Song. They are the people who came up with the original framing of reproductive justice. They are a black women-led organization teaching about reproductive justice. You should definitely get with them to learn their framing because you need it. You need it. You need to make
it
part of the presentation.
Maybe when we're done, you could share your email with me and put me in contact. Because I'd like to have a few slides about that.
Yeah.
My wife has been telling me the same thing.
Yeah. Listen to the women who are saying this.
Anything else?
Yeah. Yeah. 8 o'clock is the time here.
Yeah. Wait a minute. Gonna cut the video. Thanks, everybody, for attending. We could adjourn the conversation.